There was once, in a quiet little corner of BookTube, a book club known as Shelf Space. And everyone there laughed and got along. And the sun shone, and bunnies hopped in the meadows, and deer grazed at crystalline lakes, and there was no strife in the world. But then one day, a book appeared that would change everything. The book fractured the United House until it became a house divided. Sides were taken, and at times, lives were lost. This is the story of that conflict.
Hi guys, and welcome back to the Library of Alanzandria. And so today, guys, today is my review of Boosh, Rage of Dragons by Evan Winter. And guys, man, not since I have been on BookTube has there been a book that was so divisive among the ranks of the Shelf Space Book Club. So this was our book pick for September, and it was much, much more divisive on where people fell on this book than anyone anticipated it being. This thing has a 4.5 on Goodreads. It is almost universally acclaimed. So when it was literally split down the middle in Shelf Space, guys, we were a house divided. It was Shelf Space Civil War. And that became the narrative under which we started taking sides in the book club on this book. Since the Shadow Government and Goodreads seem to really, really love Rage of Dragons, that's obviously the pro-reg side. And so Iron Man, if you liked this book and gave it a 3.5 or above, we put you in Team Iron Man. Pro-reg, pro-rage, if you will. Anti-rage is the Captain America side because you are apparently rising up against the established government. I unfortunately have to say that I fell on the anti-reg side, and it is just so bizarre. I really need to discuss that in an alternate dimension, in an alternate parallel universe, I can see myself actually really, really loving this book. But I just didn't. I didn't have fun reading it. I didn't enjoy picking it up until the end. In fact, much of the enjoyment I had in this book came from the last 25% of it. But the problem was, is by the time I reached that last 25%, I was just over it. It just wasn't enough to bring it out of just the place that it had occupied in my brain space, that I just couldn't end up giving this a positive rating. And that makes me sad. It really does, because a lot of people who I really like a lot of BookTubers I really like, and a lot of people I really enjoy in the Shelf Space really liked it. I know Erin over at Booked and Busy loves this, and she's gonna have Evan Winter on her channel, which is freaking awesome. I know Alex Nieves loves this book. A bunch of people in the Shelf Space love it. I know Stacy liked it, Jesse liked it, Vish liked it, Jeff, Jay, Rob, Joanna loved it. But then over here on the people who didn't love it, we've got me, we've got Jesse, we've got Ina, Meredith, Sam, Abby. So there are a bunch of people who did not really enjoy it. And as the issues came up in the live show with this book, I was just shocked that we're that divided. But much of the problems, almost to a one, much of your enjoyment of this book is whether or not you like and enjoy the main character. And so we'll talk about that in a second. If you don't know, Rage of Dragons is, I'm gonna try to describe this in a way that everyone doesn't describe this, because again, when you're talking about something that's really popular, like, am I adding to the discussion? I'll try to describe it in a way that everyone doesn't. This story, it is an African-inspired fantasy novel, and the Omehi are inspired by the real-life Xhosa people from Africa. And that's really cool. The setting is really, really interesting. And the kind of shamanistic spiritual magic that is there. So the main conceit is these guys, the Omehi, have come 200 years ago. They came as conquerors fleeing their homeland. They have come to the continent of Zadin, and they have pushed the natives, the Zadini, they call them the Hedini. They've pushed them back to the outskirts, to like this desert kind of wasteland, and there's constantly a war called the Front Lines where they're fighting off the Hedini, and there's just constantly a war against the Hedini. Now, our main character, Tao, it never says how old he is, but this kid cannot be over 18. He is a teenager 100%. He just lives in his city, and he doesn't really want to be a warrior, and then something happens, and he swears revenge, and that is the inciting incident for the rest of the book. The rest of the book is about Tao's quest for revenge. So I'm gonna start talking about the things that I liked, and then I'll go into the things that kind of that just took me out of this book and prevented me from really enjoying it when in an alternate world maybe I could. And then I'm gonna talk about spoilers because I cannot talk about the specific things that bothered me without going into spoilers. So for now, I really like the setting. I think the setting is cool. I think that it's African inspired. That's neat. There's a caste system, which is awesome. The magic system is awesome. The way the dragons, when we see them, are implemented is also really cool. This whole dichotomy of the spirit world and the physical world is really neat. There are these different levels of what are called the gifted, and only women can be gifted in this society. The men train to be warriors, and the women train to be gifted, which are these kind of priestesses. And the gifted have different levels depending on their power. All of them begin with E. There's like innervators, enragers, entreaters, edifiers. They all start with E, which is already confusing as heck. But one of the coolest things that we see the most are enragers. These women are attached to what are called ingonyamas, which are, they're from the higher castes. I think only nobles can be ingonyamas. Maybe that's not true. I forget. But you have to be pretty high up in the military to be an ingonyama. And you're attached to a gifted, and she essentially draws from the power of the spirit world and just kind of like superpowers them. And the ingonyama like gets like your shirts bust and they just get huge and towering, and all of a sudden they're just like rippling. They kind of the gifted hulk them up, and so as long as they're channeling, they're just these uber warriors, and that's super cool. Now, at the top of the gifted, you have the entreaters who can summon the dragons. And the dragons live in a mountain range, and the dragons come, and the dragons are cool, and they just come and wreck crap. I don't think they have a limit like D&D dragons do on how often they can use their breath weapon, and they just like tear up some Hedini. I liked that it was a military fantasy. This should have been up my alley. A lot of people are put off by the immense amount of training sequences, and there are a lot. It is definitely reminiscent, once again, of let's get down to business.
We've got a long way to go. Let's get down to business.
Guys, anytime there's a training montage, I'm reminded of Mulan. I'm sorry, I just am. Best training montage in any media. Changed my mind. And so I like the training stuff because I like fighting. I like military. I like the band of brothers, Tao and his... I mean, I don't like saying sword brothers, but that's what it is. Tao and his little band in their little company, they're cool. His allies, the side characters, are really my favorite part of this book. Uduak the giant, love him, he has a thirst. And then Hedith the strategist, love him. Jayed, who's over their little company, is probably the most complex character in the book. He doesn't always do things for the right reasons. He just has complex motivations, which cannot be said about our boy Tao. The coughing guy, it begins with a C, I don't remember his name, but how do you become an elite warrior when you can't stop coughing? I don't really understand that, but there it is. So the side characters are really cool and really interesting, but we do not get a POV from them. This is all completely single focused in Tao's POV as he goes on his quest for revenge. I also really enjoyed the times it stopped being about Tao's quest for revenge, and when it anything dealing with the Hedini, I thought that the savages, as the Omehi call them, the stuff dealing with them, I thought was really interesting. Almost more interesting than the people we've spent the whole book with. So that kind of dealings, the stuff that happens where the plot kind of zigs and zags in that last quarter, that section was the most interesting for me and almost pulled it out to where, because I did, for the most part, enjoy reading that last section. The problem is that I did not enjoy reading anything leading up to that. And so let me talk about the things that I didn't like. And this book was doomed from the start, and I mean that literally, because I have not hated the first 50 pages of a book as much as I hated the first 50 pages of this book. I don't know what it was about it, but it took me 4 days to get through the first 50 pages of this book. It was, and in fantasy, we're used to world-building words, buzzwords, I call them. We're used to a lot of those. And so I should have been inured to this, but I was not. The prologue and chapter one, to me, was just an onslaught of a massive tower of buzzwords that mean nothing, that have no context, and are just like plowing forward like a bulldozer, just bowling over me, set in a conflict that I have no attachment to and that I don't understand. So the prologue begins with this big conflict. It's 187 years prior to the main action of the story. And then there's another kind of large-scale battle in chapter one. And the problem is, and this continues on even toward the end of the book, I do not enjoy the way the author writes large-scale conflicts. I could not picture it. I couldn't picture what was happening. I couldn't picture what was going on. I was very, very confused and left in the dark. Now, I think that his writing of single combat is much better, and I can always tell what's going on when it's like a couple people, like a band of people fighting a band of people. That was fine. But anytime it was large-scale conflict, I was just like left in the dark. And you couple that with a million buzzwords, guys, it was like I didn't have this kind of problem playing the opening 3 hours of freaking Xeno movie. And if you've ever played any of the Xeno sagas, like it's, or Star Ocean 3, it's nothing but every 3 seconds, check your glossary, because who knows what a gnosis is, or Udu, or Utik, or any of the other freaking things that are in Xenosaga. I never thought I could be just like, you know, it's you know that meme where the kid is like looking at the hose, and then he presses it and it sprays him in the face? That's what it felt like. I was just lost. And so my enmity toward those first 50 pages soured the rest of the experience, where a lot of times there are things in fantasy and there are things that just certain authors have certain quirks and you're like, yeah, you know what? I don't really get it, but I'll go along with it. None of that goodwill existed in me after those first 50 pages. It did not help that I... And guys, I don't like being negative on stuff, especially with an author that seems as nice as Evan Winter. He does. I've watched his interviews. Seems like a nice guy. He's proud of his product. And you know what? He should be. I haven't written a book. You wrote a book. It's doing really well. Like, congratulations. I am really impressed with that. But for me, as a reader, I did not like this author's writing style. The prose especially, and it got slightly better as it went on, like as if they were written far apart. The opening pages are so choppy. I haven't read choppier prose than that in a long time. Really short staccato sentences. There was just no rhythm or flow to it. Compare it to someone like Josiah Bancroft, whose prose is just like musical and beautiful. It just didn't work for me. it just didn't work for me. And so because I disliked those first 50 pages, I was just not in a very forgiving mood for the rest of it. The prose is a lot of what, just small things. There are two big things that I'm gonna talk about in spoilers. But beyond those two big things, it was death by a thousand cuts. There were just so many tiny things that bothered me. Like the romance and just the dialogue isn't good. And we talked about this in the live show and some people justified it by saying that they're teenagers, so it's supposed to be awkward. And you know what? I get that. However, the onus is on the author to show us that he's acknowledging that this is an awkward teen romance, to where it seems like, to where at any point the characters acknowledge the awkwardness so that it doesn't just seem like it's a poorly written romance. Does that make sense? If we know that you know the rules, it's fine to break them because we're acknowledging that you are telling us that this is an awkward romance, so it's gonna seem awkward. Instead, it just seems poorly written. There's some bad lines in there, guys. Like, I think about you almost as much as my training. It's just cringeworthy. And the female characters, I mean, as Abby said, where do women at, y'all? Like, they're not well-developed. The main love interest, we don't even know why they like each other, other than she's pretty. And she really exists to give us information about the magic system. And that's one of the problems of this being singular POV. It's only told through Tao's perspective, except when it's not. And if you're gonna make it not single POV at some times, think about doing it for the whole book. We're thrown into some other people's heads sporadically, but almost the entire thing is told from Tao's point of view. And because of that, because he's an idiot and doesn't understand, you know, he doesn't understand the magic system, the only way we're gonna get a glimpse here is that the love interest, who is one of the gifted, sits down and in two scenes literally instructs us. She pulls down that little whiteboard thing that old-timey classrooms have, and she gets out her ruler and she points and says, this is how the magic system works. When this happens, this happens. You can't do that. And I mean, it's just not super, it just didn't jive with me. Other small things like forgetting the heights of characters and not being consistent with the heights, not being consistent with people's motivations, with just cheesy cliches, with tiny things like not researching the fact that bronze weapons don't spark. And I know that's nitpicking and I don't want to nitpick, but it's just, When there are a thousand of these things, it just begins to wear on me. And again, I wasn't in a particularly forgiving mood because of that first 50 pages. So this is a case of the author's writing style just not being a good match with me. And this doesn't even include the main character. I did not feel that Tao's motivation was justified. I'm going to talk about that in my spoilers. He just didn't have any kind of personality for me. His personality trait was, I want to kill people. These specific people. That's it. But he never thought about how tragic what has happened to him was. He didn't think about the people this affected. He didn't think about the injustice of any of it. It's just revenge. And this, I think, was a really missed opportunity. Part of the reason he is seeking revenge is his doing. He caused it. I didn't buy the inciting incident, but if we are gonna buy it, let's give him the benefit of the doubt. He caused it. If at any point Tao had reflected on that, on his own responsibility and what was happening, more interesting automatically. Tao to me was also much more interesting as a kind of a symbol versus the nobility. When Tao was being used to talk about how unfair the caste system is, guys, that's my justice bone. Like, that was infinitely more interesting than his, for me, kind of pointless quest for revenge. And so it was just a missed opportunity for me. There were just so many things that just didn't work for me. Guys, if you love this book, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with you liking this. I can see where people could like this, but I just could not get past some of the things that just bothered me and haunted me like a ghost through the whole thing. Tao is just stubborn. He is one note. I didn't feel like he had any kind of emotion. We were in his perspective, but we were never in his head. He didn't really think about anything. Maybe some inner monologuing might have created some depth to his character. And it's just so frustrating because there's just a lot of stuff that I just thought was kind of dumb. And, you know, like, you can disagree and that's fine. Like, I was really close to 1,000 subscribers before I lost all of them because I didn't like this book. I'm sorry I didn't. I'm sorry I didn't enjoy it, but I just did not. So, I'm going to talk about spoilers for the rest of this if you're interested. So I'm going to go ahead and give this my rating before I talk about spoilers so that you can see it and then you can go. On the Kingfin approval system, I give it a fair plus. It's a fair plus, and that's only because of the last quarter. Because the Kingfin approval system is my enjoyment. Did I enjoy it while I was reading it? No. No, I didn't. I didn't look forward to picking it up. I just didn't, and it pains me to have to finally lodge something in the fair plus range. But there it is, fair plus. Out of 5 stars, 2.5. It's about a half as good of I enjoyed it about half as much as I enjoyed, say, Saint's Blood. If on Goodreads, I'll probably round it up to a 3, because I generally round the half stars up. But it's a 2.5. I didn't hate it quite as much as a couple other people in the book club, but I just really didn't enjoy it. Now, if you want to hear the specific, like the actual specifics of why, stay tuned, because now I'm going to talk in spoilers. So guys, there are two major things that bothered me. And the first one is the inciting incident that causes his desire for revenge. And the second one is his power up, which I just didn't buy it. Even given the rules of the world. In fact, my argument is that Evan Winter broke the rules established in his own world to power him up. And that's a problem for me. But let's talk about Aaron, Tao's father, being killed. I didn't really care. I didn't have a super big relationship with his dad. And then I just didn't understand. It just happened. It seemed so forced when all of a sudden the people are there and all of a sudden the nobles are watching and all of a sudden Aaron's son, Tao, is forced to spar with a noble and he's not allowed to fight back. Like, I don't even know how that's sparring. It doesn't make sense in a military world that if they really need sparring like that, one, why they would let lesser spar with them, because they're obviously not getting any better if the other person can't fight back. And if they are allowed to fight back and hit them, I don't know why anyone would ever spar with them if hitting them means instant death. It comes out of nowhere. To me, it is wearing a big fat sign that says inciting incident. It didn't feel organic to me. I would have much preferred it be something related to the family that Lekan killed earlier. That was a much more meaningful and powerful thing to me than this other thing was. If somehow Tao had assaulted Lekan when he found out that Lekan had killed those guys, that is better for me. I would have been with Tao better than this stupid thing with some random noble kid. I didn't understand it. It felt really forced, and because of that, I couldn't ride with Tao on his little revenge journey because it just seems so lame. Now let's talk about his power up, and this is really where my problem lies. First of all, the whole power upping thing, it really felt to me like the Omehi history begins with Tao, as if no one in the military had ever thought to use two weapons before. Second, I'm sorry, but there's a reason that D&D punishes dual wielding for characters that dual wield, that you have a less a chance to hit. It is hard to dual wield. I don't think that I don't care how much you've been training and how good you are, you can't just all of a sudden fight with two swords. You can't. Tao is only at this for a year. And at this point, this is pre-Isihogo, right? When he gets his dual wielding. I don't buy that he all of a sudden is really good at dual wielding in that short a period of time. I don't, because who's teaching him? Who is training him? Guys, doing something over and over again doesn't necessarily make you better. And if it does, if you're doing it without a teacher, it takes so much longer. So who is training him on two swords? Is it Jayed? Is it Jayed's second, begins with an A, I forget his name? Who's training him on two swords? Well, no one's ever used two swords in the history of the army. So I don't know how he is getting good at dual wielding. And it's not just because he gets up early. Guys, practice doesn't make perfect. Perfect practice makes perfect. And so his sudden ability to fight with two swords does not seem accurate. First of all, I don't know how really any of them are getting better. Let me just kind of take a derail where Jayed, he's got this strange new plan to use these new tactics to train this new force. We don't actually ever see what he's doing other than making them fight each other. Is that it? Is that his new tactic? Is they're just fighting each other where the nobles are like doing forms and dancing with like, ooh, swan form, ooh, form of the mountain. Like, is that Jayed's tactics? We don't ever see anything super genius or original about what they're doing. But because I like Mulan and accept that people get better in training montages, I'll go ahead and give that a buy. But the dual wielding thing doesn't, it just doesn't play with me, guys. It just doesn't. And now, let's talk about what you're all going to be upset is the Isihogo thing. Guys, in theory, I think the Isihogo thing is really interesting. I do. In theory, I think that that could have been super cool. I've never seen anything like that, utilizing something where time doesn't pass so that you can train like, you know, a whole bunch without any time passing. That is theoretically cool. However, and this is where when I brought this up in the shelf space discussion, no one was able to give me a response to my satisfaction. Because, okay, so what he does to get better is he goes to Isihogo at night and he trains with demons, all right? And he gets killed tons of times in Isihogo, but time doesn't really pass there, and so he's able to train a whole bunch against really deadly opponents, and that's how he gets better. I'm okay with that in theory. But my problem with this is multifold, okay? My first problem is that, once again, we're assuming that only Tao exists in this world. Tao is the only one who has ever wanted anything from the military. It doesn't really make sense because he gets this information from Zuri, his girlfriend. Are we assuming that no gifted has ever told their boyfriend or told anybody outside of the circle of gifted about the rules of Isihogo? And so we assume that no one has ever had this idea before to do that. If Tao can have that idea, I promise you other people who also want to be the best at it can figure it out as well. It's not some hidden knowledge. Like, Tao did not stumble across this hidden knowledge somehow to where only he would have access to it. It doesn't make sense that no one in the history of the Omehi has never had this idea before to battle the demons. Now, if they have, and they just haven't because it's too deadly, because remember, early on, more than one time, Winter has established under his own rules that even the nobles, who are stronger of mind and blood, in theory, remember, only the nobles can use the enraging because their blood is stronger or whatever. So the nobles, theoretically, are bigger, stronger, faster. They're just superior to the lessers, right? So why is it that we have seen already in the book multiple nobles lose their minds from dying in Isihogo one time? One time, and their entire psyche shatters. It does not make sense to me. It just doesn't. It doesn't make sense to me that Tao can die thousands of times training against the demons, which I think is cool, but he can die thousands of times without his psyche shattering. It doesn't make sense because Winter gave us no reason on why he should be able to do that. And I'm sorry, his willpower, he wants it more, is not a good reason that he can survive thousands of deaths. I would buy it if it was like a handful, even, you know, a dozen. Just like, I would be fine and I would step back off of this. But it's thousands of times. And Winter could have fixed this by having something occur where he can do that. But he has learned no new skills. There is no skill that allows him to survive other than force of will, and I don't buy it. I don't buy it. And don't tell me that he sees demons. Like, I get it. I get that there is some repercussions from it. He sees demons, fine. But it doesn't explain to me why the nobles can die in Isihogo once and have their mind shatter. Tao can die thousands of times and not have his mind shatter. And you know what? Maybe you can overlook that. And if you can, that's awesome. Like, if you thought that was really awesome, like I know Leslie loves this part. And Leslie, you're amazing. I love Leslie. She's the best. But I just can't. I just couldn't. I couldn't buy it. And because of that, I was just like, man, this dude's super powered for nothing. Like, how does no one else do this? If it's that easy, like, you don't think Kalan can go down there and do that? Please don't get mad at me, guys. We're allowed to disagree on books. If this didn't bother you, that's awesome. Like, I loved hearing why people in Shelf Space loved this book. And I envy them. It felt to me like a magic eye drawing. You know those magic eye paintings from the 90s where everyone, like that scene from Mallrats where everyone can see the sailboats and poor Ethan Suplee is like, I can't see it, and he kicks it over.
Sailboat.
That's what it felt like to me. Everyone else was seeing the sailboat, but I just wasn't reading the same book. So it was just a frustrating read for me. I will say here at the end, the ending, the stuff at the end with that stuff is so much more interesting to me. With Tao as a symbol of overthrowing the caste system and this the nobles versus the lessers here and the betrayal of the Zadini. Like that stuff is cool. And that stuff was good enough, and the prose I feel got better toward the end of the book. I liked that stuff enough that I am going to read Fires of Vengeance. I am going to read the second book. I'm not going to do it in November, but I am going to read the second book. So I ended up not hating it, but I cannot give a high rating to a book that I disliked for most of it. You know what I mean? So anyway, guys, hopefully you see where I'm coming from. Hopefully we can agree to disagree. I'm fine engaging in stuff down in the comments, guys, but let's not be rude. Like, you know, don't start throwing rocks. Like, don't start standing on my sidewalk and screaming at me like Patrick Rothfuss does every time you ask when the third book of the Kingkiller Chronicles is coming out. Like, let's not do that. But I hope you like this video. I hope I can give voice to the silent minority who is quietly wondering, you know, am I weird for not liking this book? We're allowed to have differing opinions. All of you who love this book, I love you very much, and I hope we can still be friends. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you next time.